We have a seminar in QLS, Quantitative Life Sciences. It will be in former Fermi building. Okay. And it's on stochastic thermodynamics of quantum systems. So it's sort of related to the course of David Wolpert. So you are welcome to join if you want. It's 3:30. 3:30, you should go to Leonardo building and then to the ex-CISA building, second floor, and it's in the open space common area. Okay. Are you all set?
Yes, okay. It's okay.
So let's start.
Okay, so yesterday we have seen some question of principle that are important for the thermodynamics and the statistical mechanics of systems with long-range interactions. We have talked about additivity, extensivity, and we have started to see the consequences of these. So my objective yesterday was to cover 26 slides, and I covered 12. So I was going very, very slow. So today I will try to get more into the game. And last night when I was preparing the solution of the exercises that I gave you, I found this sentence in the book of one of the most prestigious book in StatMech, the Wang, that I recommend that you should read, although it is sometimes some of his remarks are can be doubted, and in fact, sorry?
What's the book?
Kelson Wang, Introduction to Statistical Mechanics. So, and I found the sentence in the chapter on the perfect gas that I was consulting to see what he had in the book. There seems little hope that we can straightforwardly carry out the recipe of the microcanonical ensemble for any system but the ideal gas. So I will try to convince you today that this is not true, so that you can do it. And specifically for the Blume-Capelle model, you will see that it's possible to solve the model and many other models in the microcanonical ensemble. And why I insist on the fact that I would like to solve them in the microcanonical ensemble, because you will understand today there is a property of the Legendre-Fenchel transform that is important, that for non-concave and non-convex functions, the Legendre-Fenchel transport does not have the dual property. So if you Legendre transform twice, and the Legendre transform as a singular point, twice the Legendre transform is not the function itself. And this is a very important property of Legendre-Fenchel transforms, and it's important also for StatMech. And so today the lecture will be essentially devoted to that. So since the Legendre-Fenchel transform does not have this property, then you cannot get the microcanonical entropy from the free energy if the free energy has a singular point. So if the free energy, in fact, you can say that, okay, the singular point must be a point of discontinuity in the first derivative. If it is a if it is a point where the convexity is a zero, you can still go on. But if it is a discontinuity in the derivative, then you are in trouble. Okay, so I learned all this from a good friend of mine, Ugo Tuschetta. In fact, I was the referee of his PhD thesis in McGill University long ago, and which is constitutes also the subject of a beautiful review paper that he wrote in Physics Reports. And I recommend, if you want to go deeper into this problem, that you read his physics reports on large deviations, where you will find some of these statements. Okay, so today I will try to contradict Kelson Wang, which is not easy task because he was a very tough guy. Okay, so first of all, I had a slide, and it's important that I give a few details on this slide because Nicolò will cover this issue more deeply. So this is a plot where I put on the x-axis the dimension of the system and on the y-axis the variable sigma. I remember to you that sigma is, I never remember if it's alpha minus d, or I think it's alpha minus d. Yes. Alpha is the decay of the long-range interaction. D is the dimension, and this is the definition of sigma, which is more used than in the sigma is more used in the field theory literature. So I will be very brief, but just to give you a scheme that might be useful for you to remember. So, of course, if sigma is negative, that means that if d is larger than alpha, you are in the so-called non-additive region, which is the region, the sector here, okay? And I don't consider exponents that are positive, so I limit myself to this non-additive region. And then, so there is no proof, but in this non-additive region, if you go to a critical point, the critical point will be of the mean field type. So you don't expect to have critical exponents that are different from the mean field. There are proofs. There is a series of papers by Hidetoshi Nishimori and also some paper by Takeshi Mori and others that are more formal, but okay, so this is literature that I will not cover. It's interesting literature, but I will not cover. So if sigma is positive and you are in this sector and you are below d over 2, there is a very easy argument that is based on fluctuations that you find is sort of Landau-Ginzburg argument that you find, for instance, in a paper that we wrote together with David Mucamella that says that the exponents are mean field. So you can extend from the non-additive region to the additive region, because in this region, as I showed yesterday, the energy is additive. The energy is non-additive only if you are in the sigma negative sector. And then there is a very interesting region here. You see in this sort of sector where there are exponents that are non-trivial. So there's a critical point here which is non-trivial. And there are a lot of studies of this, including using field theory, using numerics, and anything that you want to try. But there are no rigorous results, apart from a region where you can use a renormalization group, which is near four dimension here. So there have been studies of this line near four dimensions. And there is a point here which is quite well known in two dimensions. And in one dimension, very likely it is one. The region is a limit of this region. And then in this region, you have the usual short-range exponents of the renormalization group in short-range interactions. So
is it modern?
It's a very general type of, so it's a sort of a scheme. I, I, I'm collecting a lot of information on this. For instance, you might think, what about Costelli-Stowless type of phase transition? And for instance, this point here is Costelli-Stowless, so it's not really Ising. So, and also there is randomness, so I didn't put randomness on that. And if you put randomness, then the lines are slightly different. So no disorder, Landau type and Wilson type phase transitions, including some aspects of XY or yeah.
So essentially, this is
equilibrium. If you want, yes, it's sort of generic, and I don't have an exact line. This point is for Ising, and there are extensive, and it is related to the anomalous dimension of the Ising model in two dimensions. So there are field theory arguments. I would essentially say the universality class of phi 4 theory plus maybe something of XY. Okay. So, and of course, you can superpose to this quantum and all that. So, okay. So, this is just to give you the feeling of the. There are exactly solved models for the exponents, for instance, the spherical model that gives exponents in this region. So essentially, you have non-additive mean field exponents, non-trivial long-range exponents, and short-range exponents. This is more or less the picture, okay, of this long-range. Okay, and you will see in the talk by Nicolò, he will come back on this in the quantum domain and will show some calculations of these exponents. In particular, together with Nicolò, it was a subject of his PhD thesis, we have tried to understand this line in terms of what we call an effective dimension. In fact, this idea of the effective dimension goes back to Parisi and collaborators. And we have tried to give precise estimates of this effective dimension that is a sort of calculating the line that separates long-range exponents from short-range exponents. This has to do with criticality, not with phase diagrams. And so the lectures will be mostly on criticality. Yes? I mean, the usual one of the Ising model in two dimensions.
Yes, but in this graph, because you represent sigma and then the dimension.
Yes.
And the what are the points and the lines?
The lines separate four regions, this region, this region, this region, and this region, okay? And it's just to give a picture, global picture, of what you can expect in terms of critical points in long range.
For sigma.
Critical points in long range for values of the exponents. Values of the exponent, nu, beta, the usual exponents of the critical points. So you will find different values here, but if you go here, you will find mean field exponent. Okay? So this line is very likely d over 2. This line is obtained by several different methods. And this transition is the additive non-additive, that is alpha equal d. And here you will find mean field exponents. So I'm sorry, it's very imprecise. So it's just to give you a feeling of what's going on in this field, in terms of critical exponents. So not saying anything about phase diagrams and all that, which is much more complicated. Okay, so this announcement that the three lectures of next week will be for the quantum system will be devoted in understanding some aspects of this picture. Okay, so let's go to now to the Legendre-Fenchel transform. So I don't know, maybe I... Do you know everything about Legendre transforms? So, yes? Okay, so I would like to help you with a graphical representation, which maybe is useful. So let's take an entropy as a function of epsilon. And suppose I am in the growing part of the entropy with respect to energy. And so for a given energy, I have a given entropy, OK? So, and you know that the derivative of entropy with respect to energy, in fact, here is not a partial derivative, it's just a total derivative because S depends, is beta, is the inverse temperature, okay? Sometimes I will use the Boltzmann constant equal 1, sometimes the Boltzmann constant will be explicitly indicated, it depends. Okay. 2 days ago was the anniversary of Boltzmann, so I will not put Boltzmann on the blackboard. And then I use what is called the Massier potential, which is beta times the free energy. This is phi is beta f of beta, okay? So the slope of the, I will draw it differently. The slope of the is the temperature, okay? The slope is the temperature. And if you write down, so essentially what happens graphically is the following. Maybe you know, but okay. This is the entropy. Okay, if I consider the intercept here, okay, to the y-axis, and I go down, this is beta f. Okay, this is beta f. And since the slope is beta and epsilon is this axis, so this is beta epsilon. Okay. This is useful to remember in case. And I have drawn an entropy which is convex, okay? I've drawn an entropy which is convex. There are problems if the entropy is, okay, so how do you get all this? It's on the slide. Okay, and sometimes you find the two different definitions of the Legendre transform. In one definition, this is positive. This is measured top down. In other definition, it is measured down to top. And there is no difference if you stay with concave or convex functions. And of course, if you go from concave to convex, you can just change the sign of the function. You can change the sign of the Legendre. So there is a problem of sign in all of the Legendre-Fenchel transform issue. and you will be always in trouble to understand what is the correct sign. This is what I tell you. For instance, in large deviations, the large deviation function is minus the entropy. But there is no problem, because you can formulate the Legendre transform in the right way, and you adjust this sign. All this comes geometrically from the fact that either you measure from zero to infinity like this, or you take this as a negative value. So it depends. Depends where. So essentially, you see here what the Legendre transform tells you is this. That S epsilon, the beta epsilon is S epsilon plus beta F of beta. And of course, you have to interpret this, because this is beta and epsilon. And of course, this has a meaning only if you represent epsilon as a function of beta, or beta as a function of epsilon. OK, this is something that is well known. OK, but I want just to stigmatize this fact. Okay, what happens? So in this slide, okay, I simply say this, and okay, I add some more graphical information on the blackboard, and if the function is concave. So Ugo told me that a way to remember this is concave because it's a cave. It's a joke. Okay. I don't know if you if you want to laugh at that. Okay, this is concave. Okay, convex is the opposite. In fact, mathematicians sometimes say concave down, convex up, in order to remind. OK, usually the entropy is concave. And you obtain the Massier potential, so beta times the free energy. Here, I have added also the number of particles per volume, because you can also think of as Matteo was remarking yesterday, of defining the Legendre transform on the volume, which gives the pressure. Okay, so here it is defined on the energy, and it is essentially the application of the Laplace method. Okay, you start with the exponential of minus beta n times F of beta n, which is the partition sum at fixed n. Okay, this is a Gibbs factor that I don't know if you had a course in StatMech about the Gibbs. I don't have time to enter in this, but you should look at the Gibbs contradiction. Sometimes it's told that it comes with quantum mechanics, but it's not true. It's present also in classical mechanics. It has to do with the mixing entropy of identical particles. So you should really have this term. There is a beautiful discussion of this in a paper by James that I found very, very interesting. Okay, and then you express the delta function, you express the delta function in terms of the Laplace representation, and in the large n you get this. Okay, so in the large n you see that it has to be the minimum. The exponent here has to be the minimum of the. So this, sometimes you find it in a couple of pages in books, but it's condensated in these three steps. It's very simple. So it's the Laplace method to show that in the large n, the variational problem, to the right is gives the Massier potential, the free energy, and the and this variational problem gives the entropy. There is a problem if okay. So what happens at a phase transition? At a phase transition, there is a line here. There is a line with constant slope. So you are in a limiting situation where the entropy is limit convex. So there is a region where if you Lejeune transform this, okay, if you Lejeune transform this, you get a function, which is a Massier potential, with this shape, which has a singular point, a point where the two derivatives are not the same, and the two derivatives are indeed, you see, the derivatives of the Massier potential are energies, okay? The derivative of the Massier potential are energy. So there is a derivative here, which is an energy, and the derivative here, which is an energy. And these are these two energies, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. So these two slopes are connected with the energies of the linear region, okay? And so you get all the information. As is the scope of the Lejeune transform, the information that is contained in the entropy is the same information that is contained in the free energy. And if you repeat the Lejeune Fenchel on that, you get that. So you can prove that there is it's a reflective invariant. So if I repeat the Lejeune Fenchel, I get this entropy. It's okay. Have you ever seen a phase transition like this? Raise hand who saw a phase transition in this way. Okay, one, only one. And for the others, how did you see phase transitions? So never like this, never like this. Okay. Okay, so you will have to think a little bit and digest this as a description of a phase transition. And in fact, it's a description of a first-order phase transition, okay? The one that occurs more often in nature, okay? Because if you want to go to a second-order phase transition, then there are more complicated critical points. You have to adjust the parameters in order to reach the critical point. And you can do it. You can do it by adjusting a parameter. You can reduce this. And when this flat part reduces to a point, which is a singular limit, then you are at the second order phase transition. Okay? And again, there is no problem, although it's a singular point in entropy, you can get it from the free energy. Okay? Simply, the two slopes will be the same. Okay, the two slopes in the free energy will be the same. It means that there is a discontinuity in the curvature of the free energy. Okay? So, according to Ehrenfest's classification of phase transition, is a discontinuity in the second derivative of the free energy. So, it is a second-order phase transition, which in entropy is the reduction to a point of this flat part. Okay. And now I go into the domain of... this I took from... okay, so let's first go here and then go to the description of the... mathematical description. So for long-range interactions, you have a new phenomenon that appears, that you can have non-concave entropies. And there is nothing that contradicts the principles of thermodynamics that avoids entropy from being non-concave. So it can happen, and I will show in the example of the Blume-Capella that entropy can be non-concave. So I will draw the simplest situation, which in fact it is very hard to obtain in spin models, where the entropy is a continuous differentiable functions, and it has a region of convexity here, okay? And if you try to draw the beta energy relation in this case, okay, you will find a relation where there is not an invertible relation between energy and temperature and inverse temperature. In particular, you see here, for instance, at a given temperature, you can have several different energies. The slope, if you think of the definition of the Lejeune transformer, is not directly related to the. So there are regions in different energy regions with same slope. You can do it by looking at this function here, of course. For instance, this is an example. Okay, this is a point that has the same slope. In fact, in the theory of non-concave functions, Lejeune-Fenchel transform for non-concave function, this has a name. This line has a name. It's called the supporting line. And it's a line that you adjust on the curve in such a way that the curve is below this line. And of course, if you replace the function by the function itself plus the supporting line, you get exactly the situation of the first order phase transition that I was describing before. So, and if you do this, in the corresponding beta epsilon plane, you do the Maxwell construction. You can prove it. So it's on the slide. I will not prove it. I leave it to you. So I leave it to you to prove that the equal area condition of Maxwell can be expressed in this way in energy. Okay, the integral between epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. Epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 are the two points where the supporting line meets the entropy function, which is wider than the region of convexity, because you see that the convexity region is here, is between epsilon, I don't read it, epsilon A maybe and epsilon B. And in this region, since the, you can write down, it's not written in terms of beta, I'm sorry, this is a mistake, I will correct. So T square is 1 over beta square, okay? So I should have replaced this by 1 over beta square. And you see that since this is positive, if the second derivative is positive, you get a negative specific heat, okay? This relation can be true only if the specific heat is negative. So the region of convex entropy is a region where the specific heat is negative. It's a region where the specific heat is negative. Then, so which is unstable in the, I will get to this later several times. It's unstable in the canonical ensemble. So it's not stable in the canonical ensemble. If you prepare states in this region in the canonical ensemble, they will be unstable. The region where the entropy is still concave here and here, okay? You see there is an inflection point here. The region where the entropy is concave are metastable regions in the canonical ensemble. They are stable in the microcanonical ensemble. They are metastable in the canonical ensemble, and the convex region is instead unstable in the canonical ensemble. This is an example. Eh? You can construct several of these Legendre-Frenchel duals. For instance, you can do it for pressure and volume and others, and you get a very, very similar. I leave you to prove that if you use the relation ds d epsilon equal beta, you also get the Gibbs rule. So the fact that the free energies are the same at epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. This is a generalized free energy where you don't perform the maximum over epsilon. You keep epsilon. So it's a representation of free energy that uses the Legendre-Frenchel transform. So it's a function of both the energy and the temperature. You have not yet maximized. And if you use the Gibbs rule, you get the Maxwell construction. Yes. Yes.
So it's assuming that essentially the system can phase separate into two parts.
Yes.
With different energies, and that can be stable.
Yes, yes.
So essentially, when you have long range interaction, I guess there is no way of separating the system into two parts.
Exactly.
Such that
yes.
Lower free energy, right?
Sure. Sure. Or if you want to think in terms of entropy, there is always an entropy access. So if I mix two, again, the construction of yesterday, no? I take a system with energy epsilon 1 and a system with energy epsilon 2, and I mix them with lambda, okay? Lambda epsilon 1 plus 1 minus lambda epsilon 2. So this system will have an entropy corresponding to the bounding line, to the supporting line. And this has a higher entropy than the system where the state is mixed. So where there are, what is the alternative? The alternative is that you have a mixed system, no? And you have the two phases, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, and they are mixed, okay? And if they don't unmix and they go here, and this is possible if there are long-range interactions, then you stay on the line of below the supporting line. Okay? This is essentially the idea. Now I have to show you that this really happens, and when I got these ideas, I didn't have a model. So the point. So then came this model, and this is a very essential contribution of David Mucamel, who, after living in my office for 6 months, he came out with this proposal. So why don't we try to solve this model? So he had worked on this model in the 70s.
Sir, it is. When they are mixed, it's the concave bar, and when they are not mixed, it's the non-concave.
Yes, it's the convex part. Yes, it's a non-concave part. Sure, perfect. So you are the only one who understood phase transition in this way, so you follow. The others are lost, I suppose. Okay. Don't worry, you will understand with the model what goes.
We have a question.
Yes?
Could you say again why you are calling the region between A1 and A2 metastable and
because I can reach this region also in the canonical ensemble if I do it very cautiously. So these are the, for instance, this is a supersaturated region of a fluid, or the, this is why I call it metastable. The one that I have raised, okay.
No, the one in the slide.
Ah, the one in the slides, okay.
Explain again why mean field works for weakly long range. Maybe you are going to
discuss. No. Mean field does not work for always for weakly long range. It works only, okay, only if you are below the D half line. Mm-hmm. And to prove it, I would need half an hour, but it will be proven by Niccolò.
Okay.
In a different way from the proof based on Ginzburg criterion, you will see a proof of that. That there is a line D half below which the exponents are mean field.
Okay.
It will be done in first or second lecture next week. I can give you a reference if you want to have a look at why. I can give you the reference of the Lesouche lectures of David Mucamel that proves this.
So there is another question, I think, on the other graph of non-convexities. Do you mean that these regions are actually accessible physically, while the region between AA and AB are not? So I think these regions are physically accessible. Oh, sorry, I should use the microphone
otherwise. So the question is, do you mean that these regions are actually accessible physically, while the region between epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, or no, epsilon A and epsilon B are not?
In the microcanonical ensemble, you can access all the region between epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. And it is stable in the thermodynamic sense. So you will be able to reach the region of negative specific heat in mm-hmm. physical systems with long-range interactions.
Mm-hmm.
So, and this happens in self-gravitating Newtonian systems. It happens in charged systems, in the Euler equation, mm-hmm. in the Onsager vortex model. So in, there are several models in which this can happen.
Okay, thanks.
Models of realistic natural system. Okay, so, but of course I have not replied to the questions. It's a very complicated question and it needs a deep analysis. Okay, so the Blume-Capelle model. So the Blume-Capelle model is a spin one model. So SI can take three values, and this is the way out from the Curie-Weiss. So instead of working with spin one half, we work with spin one because we have seen that for Curie-Weiss there is no problem. And so I don't want to enter in the description of this model. It's very important for the theory of helium-3, helium-4 mixtures. It was introduced for that purpose. And in fact, the reason why there are three states is just to distinguish the two fluids. And in this, let us look at it simply as a spin one model. So here is the usual Curie-Weiss term, okay? You see minus j over 2n sum over ij, all pairs of spin are coupled. And then there is a local term. It's very important that you don't keep only the Curie-Weiss term. You have to add some coupling, and this, otherwise you get an energy which is proportional to m squared. So, and you will not, the model is not rich enough, and you don't get what you want. So this is a parameter delta that measures how much of the fluid one you have. No, of course, if SI is either plus or minus, it gives you a contribution delta, and that's the one fluid. And then there is a zero fluid, which is the one which is the paramagnetic fluid, is as a spin zero. Okay. So the model has been solved in the canonical ensemble by Blum and Capel in the 70s, and there is a more general model that is called the Blum-Emery-Griffiths model, which has additional couplings, and it also can be solved in the canonical ensemble. The solution is very simple. So I will not do it in the lecture, but I propose to you to solve this model as an exercise in the canonical ensemble. What you have to do, I will give you the definitions, but okay, let's it's a sort of Landau type exercise, so it's not simple. Okay, you write this term as a square. Okay, you can write it as a sum of SI square. Okay, and then you apply the inverse Gaussian transformation. Sometimes it's called the Hubbard-Satanovich transformation. Okay. So, and for that you need an additional field, one additional field, which is the term in front of X sum over SI. And then you get an Hubbard-Strathonovich Hamiltonian, which has the form X sum over SI. And then you have a sum over SI square, delta, okay? I don't put a sign here, it could be plus or minus, I don't remember. So you have something like this, okay? And then you have to integrate over X, and then you have to integrate, you have to trace over sigma, okay? You have to do this. But since this is local, okay, it's a sum, so this is a product over I of e to the minus beta delta SI square, plus or minus, it depends on the sign of the SI, okay, beta SI, beta SXI. Okay, and this, of course, it's local. So you can trace here, simply on SI. And you get an expression in terms of beta, delta, and X, okay? And then you do saddle point on X. You are lost. You do saddle point on X, and you get the free energy. Okay? So if you want, okay, and we can maybe, I can devote a tutorial, I don't know, 10 minutes to go deeper into this solution. The model is not solvable in finite dimension. So there is no solution of the model in dimension 2, 3, and so on. So it was solved in this way, or slightly different by Griffiths. Okay, what happens for the free energy of this model? So for those who are familiar with this method, it's a very straightforward application, extremely straightforward application of the method. So what do you have? You have a let's go to the phase diagram, and you will understand. Okay, so first of all, the model, there are two parameters, okay, delta and J. And then there is temperature, okay? Then there is temperature. So I fix J to 1. There are three parameters, so either you divide by J here. Alternatively, you can fix J to 1. So the unit of energies is J equal 1. So and then you are in the plane delta T delta T here is not clear, but it is T, okay? And there is a line of phase transitions in this plane. There is tensions in other parts. So I will consider only delta positive and, of course, T positive. But you can extend to delta negative. There is a line of second order phase transition here, a line of first order phase transition here, which ends up with a steep slope, with a steep slope. And there is a tricritical point. You will understand more about the tricritical point. I will stop now in 2-3 minutes. And in this region, both the magnetization and the parameter Q, I go back to, there are two order parameters. That's the reason it comes from the two fluids, okay? One is the magnetization, which is the sum of the plus spins minus the minus spins divided by the total number of spins. And there is the quadrupolar moment, which is the sum of the two. Okay, there are two order parameters, because there are three species. And both in the region of, in the ferromagnetic region, they are both positive. So here, both the magnetization and the quadrupolar moment are positive. And they both have a jump at the first order phase transition line, and they are continuous at the second order phase transition line. And here, there is this mysterious tricritical point, and I will tell you more about this tricritical point in the second part of the lecture. And now we pause for 5 minutes, okay?
Okay, thank you very much.
Sì.